This is Burnsville, North Carolina, nestled in the heart of the North Carolina mountains in Yancey County. Burnsville, as well as surrounding towns such as Mars Hill, Spruce Pine, and Marshall, all have deeply held traditions that have been passed down through generations of religious belief and the practice of regional mountain music. With churches around every corner and weekly performances on the town square, it isn't difficult to observe how deeply held these traditions really are. Burnsville and Yancey County are a living example of these Appalachian traditions, and many fascinating people still live here that can give their own perspective and life experiences surrounding these subjects. Old-time music is a style of music that reflects some of the earliest aspects of rural American life in the mountains. The songs sing of issues that were universal for rural mountain folk, such as death, longing, loss, and salvation. While gaining influence from English ballads, traditional Scottish and Irish songs, and the African banjo, old-time music stands alone as one of the most visceral representations of early rural American life. In order to learn more about old-time music, stylistically and lyrically, I visited Bruce Green of the South Tow River Valley, about 20 minutes from Burnsville.
I'm Bruce Green, and I live in South Tow River in Yancey County, North Carolina. I've lived here for about going on 40 years. And I came here by way of Kentucky, where I was learning a lot of the old-fashioned traditional music over there. And when I started living here, I started looking up people that still remembered the old music that had been passed down from the pioneer days and all like that. And trying to learn the music that people have passed down in this area particularly. I'll play a fiddle tune that I learned from a man named Wellesley Cresson. And Wellesley grew up in our valley here in South Tow River. He learned from his uncle Charles Cresson, who lived up on Clear Creek, a few miles up the river. And I knew Wellesley for many years, and we played together quite a bit. He was a kind of typical old mountain fiddler that learned a little bit in his youth and never did anything real fancy, you know, but he had a lot of old tunes that nobody knew anymore and that had been passed down to him from earlier generations. So I'll play one of his. He called "The Old Black Cat Couldn't Catch a Rat." I'm out of tune.
I asked Bruce about the unique way he positions his fiddle just below his shoulder in contrast with the modern proper style that is generally positioned under the player's chin. His response was that many of the old-timers held it this way in order to see the strings and their hands when they were playing, and he just picked it up by playing with them. However, he questions whether the modern way is truly correct due to portraits he has come across from as far back as the 14th century, where minstrels could be seen holding their fiddles in the same way he does.
So, banjo was always one of the most popular instruments in this part of the country. And the old timers had two or three different ways they picked it before, you know, the modern picking is what they call a three-finger roll or whatever. And the old timers either did two-finger picking with a thumb and finger, or they did what a lot of people call claw hammer. A lot of the mountain people called it all kinds of different stuff, like knocking or rapping or overhanded, one thing or another. Because of most instruments, you pick the strings up, and this knocking style, you hit down with your finger on the strings to get the melodies. So it'd be something like this. So you can see how you look like you're knocking on it the way you hold your hand. One of the more popular ways of playing around here in the olden times was what they call a finger lead with the thumb and first finger, where you'd pick the melody just with your first finger. So it'd be like... uh, it's a real nice, slower, gentler style. It's really good for accompanying songs.
Here, Bruce and I demonstrate the original style that was old-time mountain music using only the fiddle and the knocking style of banjo playing that Bruce mentioned earlier. Today, old-time music can be heard using other instruments as well, such as guitars, mandolins, and the upright bass. Old-time music is a blend of European ballads, Christian hymnals, and blues music. Traditional African-American songs specifically would play a large role in providing inspiration for many original country music greats such as the Carter Family, Bill Monroe, Hank Williams Sr., and Jimmy Rogers. Leslie Riddle, a Yancey County native, was well-versed in the old gospel, blues, and railroad tunes. So much that when he met the Carter Family at a local black musician hangout in Kingsport, Tennessee, the leader of the Carter Family band, A.P. Carter, invited him to their home and thus began a lifelong friendship. The pair would travel across the rural South for weeks at a time, learning and collecting the old songs that would go on to help shape and define country music. Leslie had a very unique guitar playing style due to an injury. His two middle fingers were shot off during a dispute with his uncle over a shotgun. He also sustained another injury that Dylan Wilson, a Burnsville native, can recall hearing about in his younger years.
My name, we're sitting here in the house that I was born in. Came home to, maybe be the house I die in, but it's here in Burnsville, North Carolina, Yancey County. And I was born and raised here. Lived a little while in Ashe County, but I was just little. But I've lived here all my life, and we're just across the road from where Leslie Riddle's buried. But I've got one story, a Leslie Riddle story. There used to be he's dead now, a man that lived here, a black man named Rusty Griffith. And he was about this tall, he's a little short fella, and he was kind of a businessman. So I saw Rusty one day, and I hollered at him and asked him about, you know, I'd heard that he was around when Leslie lost his leg. And he said, yeah, he said I was there. But anyway, he went to get Leslie where he was working. It was at some kind of a mill, and I can't remember if it was somebody had an old grist mill, an old corn mill, or it was a spar mill, which is that's where they used to mine spar out, and they'd mill it down into powder. But anyway, Rusty went, and he said that he hollered at Leslie and said, hurry up and get your work done, Leslie, and we'll go play ball, because Leslie was a great, good ball player. And Rusty said he was waiting on him, and that Leslie was in a big hurry, and he got his leg caught in a machine, and that's when he lost his leg. And he had a lot to overcome, you know, because he'd lost, what was it, three fingers mm-hmm. on his picking hand and his leg. But it turned out to be a good thing that he lost his fingers on his picking hand, because it taught Maybelle Carter the Carter Scratch, they call it. But that's my Leslie Riddle story.
Leslie's contribution to the Carter family is often unrecognized, but significant nonetheless. The Carter family and Leslie Riddle remained friends for their entire lives. Leslie died on July 13th, 1979, and is buried on top of Windy Hill, just 5 minutes from Burnsville. His tombstone was gifted to him by AP and is made of rose marble, just as his own tombstone was. The music found within the many church houses of the Appalachian Mountains have changed over the years with regard to lyrical theme. When considering the old denominations found in the region, many old regular, primitive, or United Baptists held unique ideas regarding music. The ideology that guided these churches were of a particular age in this country where the ideas of John Calvin or Calvinism ruled. Calvinism, simply put, is the belief that God is in charge of individual destiny. The idea that God's self-sacrifice only saves those that are predestined for salvation. This belief often made for a fatalistic view on life and can be observed in the themes of the old sacred harp or shape note singing.
some of these old, like, Sacred Harp songs that people used to do, and Sacred Harp and Christian Harmony. And so many of them were about just dark, deep, serious subjects, life and death and eternity and all like that. And I was thinking about an old woman I knew up on Little Creek over here, the other side of Yancey County. Her name was Naomi Ledford. She was a honeycutt. And she had a song that I've been meaning to learn, all about Judgment Day and the end of the world, and they call it the Great Tremendous Day. About a great tremendous day is coming, what dreadful scenes are drawing nigh, and it's all about how earthquakes and the earth coming to an end and end of humanity and all. I'm
glad that I was born to die. These churches refuse to allow any instruments in the church other than the human voice, also called the Sacred Harp. Furthermore, if a fiddle player moved to town, it's said that the preachers felt threatened by the popularity that they received from the town and members of the congregation. Therefore, the fiddle would adapt the nickname of the Devil's Box, citing that if secular music distracted the town from the church this much, then the fiddle must be against God.
The old-timers used to talk about they didn't like instruments. They had no instruments. You sang... as William Ward would say, aquapella. You sang aquapella. Yeah, they didn't have no instruments, no piano, no nothing. And Big Tom Wilson, he's very famous here in the counties. But anyway, Big Tom was in church up at Laurel Branch on Pensacola, and he was the old man, so this was like in the very early 1900s. And some boy had come from Asheville to sing at the meeting that night, and he had a guitar. He was playing that guitar. And he started playing it, and that got very far in it. And they said they heard something on the floor, and Big Tom took his cane and hit the floor three or four times, and he stood up, and everybody got quiet, and he said, "I don't intend to sit here and listen to that devil music." And walked out of the church and walked home.
Today, churches in the Appalachian Mountains have adapted a more Arminian approach to their beliefs. This approach came from a desire to distance themselves from Calvinism and adopt a more hopeful religion. Arminianism stresses ideas such as free will, the possibility of universal atonement, salvation, and the dramatic human improvement through salvation. This in turn was reflected in the music that was sung in the church. Themes such as hope, God's glory and grace, faith and humility now fill churches across the mountains.
I thank God that He inspired me and blessed me to hear this music one more time. There's a sound to it that draws you, does something for you.